Good afternoon. Thank you for coming here today. As you all know, the governor called the Indiana General Assembly back into session beginning at the earliest on July the 6th of this year, or this summer, and we have set the date to begin our work beginning on Monday, July the 25th. As we speak now, the Indiana General Assembly website is updating, and bills and committee reports will be on there and posted, so you'll have an opportunity to take a look at those. I will go over a detailed schedule with you at the end of our opening remarks. But first, Senator Sue Glick and myself want to briefly outline the three bills the Indiana Senate intends to move in this special session coming up. The first, of course, deals with the abortion after the U.S. Supreme Court decision in Dobbs versus Jackson Women's Health Organization. This decision allows each state to determine its own policy on abortion, and I acknowledge that in doing so, it opens arguably the most difficult, polarizing issue that we face in a generation. I understand the passion that exists on both sides. Nevertheless, it is our job in the Indiana General Assembly to chart a course for Indiana and determine what our position is on this extremely difficult issue. First, a comment about our process. Our process will not be cut short in any way, and all of our procedural rules will be followed. With a difficult issue such as this, we need to ensure first that the debate is civil and substantive, and second, that everyone, all sides, have the opportunity to be heard. This will include lengthy committee hearings and where the public will be welcome to testify. To date, we've been working hard on proposed legislation, and during that process, we've received literally thousands of letters, emails, phone calls, and visits. Many of us have also met with numerous groups and individuals, including, in particular, Senator Glick, from all sides of the issue. As is always the case, when we get involved in legislation, we learn a lot from the folks and the experts that we speak to as we try to craft legislation. Certainly, there are two sides to this issue. Those, of course, of the life of the unborn, which many, myself included, feel as a living human being, and the women who want to have an abortion. However, as you wade into the details, you very quickly realize it is much more complex than it may have seemed at first, and opinions differ on even the most nuanced of issues and language. Our underlying goal is to protect human life, promote more adoption and less abortion by limiting abortion to the life of the mother, rape, and incest, and by being compassionate and supporting pregnant women, some of whom find themselves in extremely difficult circumstances. I now want to turn the microphone over to State Senator Sue Glick, who is authoring Senate Bill number 1. Senator Glick.
Thank you, Senator Bray. First of all, I think we need to talk about the fact that this is, we're going to try and outline the language of the bill, and we will take some questions at the end, but right now we just want to kind of go over the guidelines that are set forth in the bill. Being pro-life is not about criminalizing women. It's about preserving the dignity of life and helping mothers bring happy, healthy babies into the world. Many in the pro-life movement have long believed in exceptions to abortion restrictions for the life of the mother, and that exception is included in the bill. In addition, we recognize that there are heartbreaking cases where, because of violence committed against women and young girls, we have to provide for some additional exception. That's why the legislation we are introducing also provides exceptions in the case of rape and incest, which I believe the majority of Hoosiers accept. We want to be very clear about what this bill does not do. This bill does not affect access to the morning after pill, also known as Plan B, or any other method of birth control. This bill does not affect treatment of miscarriages, treatment of ectopic pregnancies. It does not affect in vitro fertilization procedures. Does not prohibit ending a pregnancy when the unborn child would not be able to survive due to a fatal fetal anomaly. And it does not criminalize women seeking an abortion. Senate Bill 1 also does not create any new penalties for doctors who perform abortions. The existing penalty that allows a doctor to have his or her license revoked if he or she performs an illegal abortion will remain in place. That sums up the crux of the legislation, and I'll now concede to Senator Bray, and he'll go on with it.
Thank you, Senator Glick. As Senator Glick said, our underlying goal is to protect human life by limiting abortion to the life of the mother, rape and incest, and doing everything we can to support women and babies in the state of Indiana. While we may have educated guesses about what kind of support may be needed following the implementation of Senate Bill 1, no one can predict exactly what services will be needed in a post-Roe Indiana. That said, this special session, we intend to use Senate Bill 2 to add an additional $50 million to programs to support women who are or may become pregnant, new mothers, babies, and families. We will continue to advance this effort when we come back in January for another budget session. This $50 million includes an estimated $5 million to increase the cap on Indiana's adoption credit tenfold, from $1,000 to $10,000. And we will continue to look for ways to cut red tape and reduce the cost of adoption in the upcoming legislative session. Another $45 million for the creation of a Hoosier Families First Fund. This will allocate $45 million to agencies and programs to support women from before they become pregnant to and during pregnancy to the needs of mothers, babies, and families that they may have once the baby has arrived. Some of those programs include programs that will promote the health of pregnant women, maternal support services like Real Alternatives and pregnancy resource centers, access to contraception, and pregnancy planning, including the removal of barriers where we can to long-acting and reversible contraception, in particular when the new mother leaves the hospital so she doesn't get pregnant again shortly thereafter. Nurse Family Partnerships Program, which is a pilot program that has already been moving the needle for Indiana's maternal and infant mortality numbers. First steps, increase access to daycare for low-income families through the Child Care Development Fund, additional support for foster families and adoptive families in the OB Navigator program. So all of that is contained in Senate Bill 2, which was filed under Senator Travis Holdman's name, but may ultimately end up being carried by Appropriations Chair Senator Ryan Mishler. Senate Bill 3, finally, my colleagues have come up with a proposal, given our strong fiscal position, to provide some relief to Hoosiers. First, let me say we are grateful to the hardworking Hoosiers who've kept Indiana firing on all cylinders over the last couple of difficult years. With state revenue coming in at nearly 6.2% over projections, a 15% growth in income tax, a 10% growth in sales tax, and a reserve fund found just north of $6 billion, our state is in a strong financial position. Even with our rainy day fund set, Even with our rainy day amount set aside and the maximum $2.5 billion being transferred to our pre-96 teacher pension fund, happening right now as we speak, by the way, we still have about $1 billion in excess reserves we can use to help Hoosiers while continuing to be good stewards with taxpayer dollars. This is fantastic news. Unfortunately, at the same time, Hoosiers are saddled with rapid inflation. As a nation, we experienced 9.1% inflation in June, just last month. And we're hit particularly hard on food and gas. But core inflation is up significantly as well. While wages have increased due to inflation, and so has the need for workers, those wages don't seem to be going as far. Nationally, real wages fell by 1% in June alone. There is a consequence to this, as there is to all irresponsible spending that goes on in Washington, D.C. And the bottom line is that Hoosiers are hurting. And as good as Indiana's bottom line looks, our state dollars don't go as far as they could either. In fact, some of the major capital projects we passed in our last budget have not been carried out because inflation has carried the price well past the amount of money budgeted to complete those projects. Additionally, while we have been making great progress over the years, we still have significant unfunded pension obligations to our teachers' pre-96 pension fund. We are proposing Indiana take care of Hoosiers and at the same time take care of our own fiscal house. To give relief to Hoosiers, Senate Bill 3 contains the following: a six-month reprieve from the 7% sales tax on all residential utility bills, including gas, electric, water, and phones. Nearly every Hoosier will benefit from this every month on every utility bill. Secondly, while we feel the utility sales tax freeze will benefit more Hoosiers in a more meaningful way than a totally suspending the gas tax, our members think it's important that we not allow any further increases in taxes at the pump for the remainder of this fiscal year through June 30th of 2023. As you know, sales tax on gas fluctuates each month based on the average price of gas across the state of Indiana. Senate Bill 3 temporarily caps that rate at 29.5 cents per gallon, and it suspends the increases to the gas tax and special fuel tax that took effect on July the 1st. Both of these policies will remain in place until June 30th of 2023, which is the end of the state's fiscal year. These two changes combined mean the total taxes drivers pay at the pump cannot increase until next July, though of course the taxes can go down if the prices continue to fall. This is a cap, it is not a freeze. Also, $400 million to pay down the pre-96 teacher pension fund, which is currently has an outstanding liability of $9.8 billion. Our caucus thinks it's important to continue aggressively paying down that long-term obligation so Hoosier taxpayers don't have that hanging over their heads any longer than necessary. Another $215 million to fund the much-needed capital projects that have been outpaced by inflation that were originally funded in our 2021 budget. We've had many ongoing discussions about what the best way to provide relief to Hoosiers is in this inflated economic environment, but we believe suspending the sales tax on utilities and capping fuel taxes is the best way to go to provide relief to nearly all Hoosiers and ensure that money stays in the state of Indiana. That brings me to the end of our prepared remarks on the bills. I now briefly run you through what we expect to be the schedule for the first week of this special session in the Senate. You will be receiving a detailed copy of this schedule following the conclusion of this press conference. On Monday, that's July 25th, we will convene session at 11 a.m. to introduce bills on first reading. From 1 to 5 p.m. that day, the Senate Committee on Rules and Legislative Procedure will take up public testimony on Senate Bill 1 right here in the Senate chamber. The committee will meet again on Tuesday to take more testimony from 9 a.m. till noon. And we will take a vote on the bill after testimony is concluded on Tuesday morning. Also on Tuesday, the Senate Committee on Appropriations will meet to hear Senate Bills 2 and 3. The Senate will meet for session to adopt the committee reports on Wednesday. We will meet on Thursday for second reading, and we anticipate meeting for third reading on Friday. That brings us to the end of these prepared remarks, and we are now ready to take any questions if you have them.
Brian, a couple quick questions. Number one, on the right now in the Senate, current law, a woman can get an abortion under 20 weeks with no issue concern. Was there any talk or discussion about moving that sort of that maybe 20 weeks to 15 weeks for the gestation period?
Quite a bit of conversation on that. That's not in the bill at this point in time.
So to clarify, yeah. This is a zero total ban, basically, aside from those exceptions.
This is a it limits to abortions to the life of the mother, rape and incest.
Senator, what role did the case of the Ohio 10-year-old girl who had to come here in order to obtain an abortion because she was raped in Ohio and couldn't get an abortion there, what did that play in these discussions?
Obviously a big story. I think everybody in our Senate caucus paid attention to that heart-wrenching, tragic story. If you look at this bill as I've described it, that young girl would have an opportunity here in Indiana to be treated. Ultimately, yeah, the doctor's going to have a lot to determine there. The language is essentially very, very similar to language we've had in the Indiana Code here since 2011. It says it's permanent and substantial impairment to the life of the mother, is basically what the language will say.
Will a prosecutor second guess that?
I'm sorry?
Will a prosecutor second guess that? And will a doctor, in the case of a loss of license or some authority, such as a prosecutor, decide that it wasn't?
Well, the prosecutor doesn't have authority, I don't believe, to take a doctor's license under those circumstances.
Senator, by limiting women and people's access to abortion,
Well, so one of the reasons really is procedural. This is a, that's a lot of money, and it's and keep in mind, it's $50 million. That will get us through. We'll be in session in beginning in January again, so we'll take a look to see what more we can do to continue to provide assistance to women and their babies. But we have rules, and so any bill that has a fiscal on it needs to run through the Appropriations Committee. This allows that bill to run through the Appropriations Committee, and the Senate Bill 1 to run through the Rules Committee.
Senator,
Yeah, as we've got it set up right now, yes, you could.
What would you say?
The rape and incest exception does not require the charging or conviction of a crime.
It does not.
Why write it that way?
Well, you couldn't require the conviction of a crime because that normally would take more than 9 months to complete, obviously. Now, it does, the language does require that an affidavit be signed and provided to the physician. Well, you know, this is a really, really challenging issue, and you have to weigh the right for women to make these decisions, along with the right of the child that's not born yet, and that's very significant to a lot of people.
Senator, has your caucus done any polling of constituents?
What's that?
Has your caucus done polling of constituents?
Yeah, we've looked at some polling across the state. It's kind of across the board. It depends a lot on basically how the question is asked.
Senator, as for that social services bill, state records show last year nearly 8,000 Indiana residents obtained an abortion. How do you know that the funding you're proposing right now is going to be enough?
Well, as I said in my comments, we don't necessarily know that it's going to be adequate off into the future, but this is $50 million that will get us just through January. And because we're back in January, and we're going to do a new budget then, so we'll continue to add to it. And obviously, we're in July now, coming up on August, and so a lot of these babies won't be born through the rest of this calendar year. So we want to begin, though, to ramp up these programs, make sure they're adequate, make sure there's adequate staff and services for what will be probably a bump in the need.
Are you and lawmakers willing to dip into the surplus to cover those additional expenses?
Well, that's $50 million. And plus we'll continue to work on that in this next budget session.
Senator Blake said that this bill wouldn't affect the morning after pill, contraception, medications that are used for miscarriages and other conditions. But we've seen in other states that pharmacists are afraid to pass or to dispense these drugs, are worried about running afoul of the law. So how can we guarantee people that they will still have access to this when this is an almost total ban on abortion?
I think, if I might, when we're looking at birth control measures, the prevention of of conception, it's a different avenue. We want to work with young people. We want to work with young ladies of childbearing age and give them the opportunity to prevent conception in such a way that's scientific, it's safe. There's a number of ideas that have been floated out there, including the possibility of maybe pharmacists prescribing birth control. But there has to be measures in place to protect both the pharmacists and the individual receiving. There has to be items have been suggested, such as blood pressure testing for anyone applying for birth control at the pharmacy. Some pharmacies don't carry birth control measures. That's up to them. So it's a fluid situation in terms of we can't mandate them to carry them, but we certainly can provide those resources. We want to make as many avenues available to help these people, take those steps to ensure that they're not having unwanted pregnancies. If they're not able or they're unwilling to carry a child to term, we would rather deal with it on the front end than on, at the site where we're going to an abortion or a resolution that's that serious. I think it's possible. I think basically what that money is going to be aimed at is some of the pregnancy centers, the first steps, and those clinics and programs, women's centers, where information can be provided to people who just don't know. We have a number of pregnancies in the state of Indiana that are a result of, I don't want to say ignorance, but lack of understanding of people's body and the, you know, everyone knows where babies come from, but not everybody knows what steps they can take and what's available to them, either short-term or long-term. We want to give them as much help and assistance as possible, and for those people who are childbearing age, who have children that they're not equipped to take care of, we want the state of Indiana to assist them in bringing healthy babies into this world and taking care of them after they get here. It doesn't do us much good to bring children into the world if we're not going to assist and help our people take care of those youngsters as we go along.
I want to add on to the question there just briefly, if I could. I think your question was, do we want to try to expand contraception? I think the question or the answer to that question is yes. We want to expand contraception where we can, and you know there are some hurdles out there in clinics when a woman comes in to get, like I mentioned in my comments, a LARC or long acting reversible contraception, but they don't have those on their shelves because they're expensive and it's difficult for these facilities to front load those. And so we want to try and be helpful to make sure that those are there when the woman comes into the facility, she can get helped now. So yeah, we're going to try and do that.
Is there any plan to expand sex education in schools to prevent teen pregnancy? Is it something that's not required currently in Indiana schools?
Well, education on that front is going to be extremely important, yes.
Senator, I want to make sure I have this as clear as possible. This is a total ban on abortion from the moment of conception, except for the risk of exceptions.
So this is limiting abortions to the instance of the life of the mother, rape, and incest. Now, it's important to the way that, and through our conversations with experts and physicians and a number of other folks, I mean, the way we characterize the language in this bill is that that point begins when the fetus implants in the uterus. And so what that means is, as Senator Glick accurately reflected, the morning after pill, Plan B, those sorts of things, ectopic pregnancies don't come into play because at that point the uterus has not implanted, or excuse me, the fetus has not implanted in the uterus. So those things are all on the table and would be available to women.
When do you believe, how are you going to prevent pregnancies that are unwanted from happening if kids don't even know how their body parts work, which is something that isn't taught maybe in the schools?
Well, it's not taught in every school, but we need to make sure that we need to work on expansion of the education, sex education.
Is it something to advocate for it to be taught in schools?
Anything else?
Senator Bray, I know some states have criminalized folks even leaving their home state to travel to an adjacent state where abortion doesn't have as many restrictions. Was that ever discussed? And if so, why not? Why didn't you guys do it?
We didn't do it. Didn't feel like good policy.
On the inflation relief bill, just to get off abortion for just a second, how much are you talking about saving Hoosiers with the sales tax holiday on utilities?
So that's about $260 million, and then the gas tax pieces would be another 50 or so million dollars, I believe.
Right. Per household, do you have any sort of guesstimate on what that would be savings-wise?
You know, it varies, obviously, but there was, I think, some, you know what, I've got it in my head, but I'm not going to say it because I might get it wrong. I'm sorry.
And then why not include the governor?
You know, we talked a lot about that, obviously, and it's been a good, robust conversation. I think that the Senate just feels like this is a better way to do it. They're not passing out money to individuals. We are providing them to save some money on their utility bills, which everyone's going to pay. And so, in addition, you know, you worry a little bit about putting additional money into the economy when inflation is already moving at 9.1%. And while Milton Friedman will tell you that the only person that can create inflation is the person that has the printing press, still dropping $1 billion into the economy right now when inflation is white hot, just feels, I have some trepidation in doing that.
Will this legislation include any kind of exceptions for where this law would potentially conflict with people's religious freedoms, for people's religion, do you support abortion for women?
I'm not sure I understood that question. I'm sorry.
The Jewish community supports abortion. The Jewish faith and the Muslim faith in Indiana do support abortion access for women in certain cases. Is there any exceptions for this legislation for people under religious freedoms?
None that are in this language.
Consider, like in other states, allowing civil actions, such as the Texas law. Is that included in any way in what you're doing here?
No.
How confident are you, I'm sure you've had discussions with Speaker Houston and others in the House, are you confident of this same proposal being supported over on that side?
No, the Speaker and I talk almost every day, sometimes more than once in a day. This is an extraordinarily challenging issue. I cannot speak to what the House will do. I've had some conversations, but I can't. And even amongst our own members, we've got 39 different opinions, I think, about, and they all feel extraordinarily passionate about that. So this is going to be a process. It's going to be difficult for all of us, and we're trying to find a path forward. And this is the start of that.
Do you anticipate significant amendments?
I certainly anticipate discussing amendments. Whether there'll be significant amendments that change this bill, I don't know at this point in time.
So there has been some conversation about the transparency of this process. What do you say to people who look at this and haven't heard from any of their legislators, and they think that this hasn't been very transparent? What do you say to them?
I think this is the start of that process. I mean, if somebody wants to write a bill about anything, just pick whatever it is. The first thing they do is they sit down and they start thinking about it, and then you start talking to people that are experts in that field, and so you can learn a little bit more about it. But you don't have public hearings at that beginning part of the process. But we are going to be we're going to run through, as I said before, every rule that we have. We're going to follow our guidelines. We're going to have hours and hours of testimony on this, so we can hear from people. And the conversations that we've had to date have been with people that are pro-life, with people that advocate for women being able to abort their babies. We've had conversations with doctors from all sorts of fields, including ACOG and the OBGYNs, which has kind of, for instance, allowed us to kind of land on pregnancy beginning at the time that the fetus implants in the uterus, as opposed to any other different time. So we've worked very hard during this last several weeks, couple of months really, trying to learn as much as we can and come up with a path that makes sense for the state of Indiana.
Federal criminal penalties for either the woman, the doctor, the Uber driver who takes her to get the procedure done. What's really changed in Indiana if there are no real criminal penalties for anything?
Well, some criminal penalties are still in place. The change is that abortion is now limited to life of the mother, rape, and incest. Well, so the language that we've landed on in this bill is the substantial, permanent impairment of the life of the mother.
So what penalties could someone face then in regards to this that are already on?
So if, for example, if a doctor gives a partial birth abortion, or this wording is a little bit different for partial birth abortions and for dismemberment abortions, but under those circumstances, there can be felony criminal consequences for that. But that is already in law today. It's not added in this bill.
And when he brings up an Uber driver, could someone driving someone to get an abortion face a penalty?
No.
Last question.
What about somebody who orders medication abortion and gets telehealth care from an abortion care provider in, say, Illinois or California?
So telehealth, for abortion services, telehealth would not be an option. This bill does not permit it. Thanks, everybody.
Thanks,
everybody. Appreciate you.
Mike still hot? Everybody still in here? Okay. I'm Greg Taylor, state Senate Democrat caucus leader, and I just listened to the same press release and received the same documents that I hope you've received here today. I think this is a clear indication that we're in trouble and that the state of Indiana has determined that it's time to take a step back in regards to women's health. While I did have a chance to peruse some of the information in the bill, the proposed bills that are opening up, there were two glaring issues that I think the citizens of the state of Indiana should be very concerned about. One is that this is an outright ban on abortion. There are no time period exceptions for abortion under this legislation. In addition, the exception for the life of the mother still does not consider her health as a consequence of having a child. So, for example, a woman who is on dialysis, who receives a notice from her doctor that, hey, you're pregnant and you're going to have to suspend your dialysis treatment because we can't do it because you're pregnant. We'll have to make a very serious choice on whether or not to have a child. In addition, the rape and incest, you're going to ask a woman to admit on an affidavit that is supposed to be confidential, but there will be no penalties, listen to this, for the male who actually committed that rape or incest. That is a step back on protection for women. Last but not least, if you notice in the schedule, the health committee is no longer going to receive this piece of legislation. The health committee in the Senate has 6 females on the committee out of 12. This legislation will go to rules, which is run by the leader, President Pro Tem Bray, has 1 female, the author of this legislation. That is factual, and that is clear that women in the start of this discussion will have very little, if any, voice. I find it hard to stand here as a male having this discussion with you about abortion because it's not a decision that I would ever have to make for myself. But for those women here in the state of Indiana who are watching, who understand what this means, this is not a step in the right direction. On the financial bills, I say hoorah to my colleagues for actually bringing forth legislation that we've already proposed in the past and they voted no for. We proposed, Senate Democrats proposed, funding for doulas in the state of Indiana. Now it's in their legislation. The Senate Democrats proposed suspending the gas tax. Now it's in their legislation. The Senate Democrats proposed assisting women so that we are not at the top of the list for infant mortality. And now we're finally going to do something about it. So we applaud our colleagues for coming up with some ideas to help Hoosiers in the state of Indiana. It's about time. We should have done it months ago when we knew this was coming and we knew we would have a budget surplus. But now we are here and we are excited to have this discussion and determine whether or not it's Indiana's moving forward or backwards. So I'll open it up for questions. Yeah. Yes, they caught the car, Abdul, and now they don't know what to do with it. We will be introducing amendments to this. We just got the legislation today, so forgive me for not being able to give you more precise information, but we will be submitting amendments to this legislation, absolutely.
So it'll only be through amendments that you'll be...
Through amendments. We will have bills, but something tells me when they go to Rules Committee, they're going to die a slow death, so it's not going to be heard. This is what I will say to you about that process, however. It intrigues me. It intrigues me that it may take the Senate Democrat caucus to show up in order for us to have a quorum in the Indiana General Assembly come Monday. Please count the number of members that will be here and present. It will intrigue me because that means that for the 34 members that are here, they still need 26 votes to pass any legislation. So just stay tuned. It may confuse some of you, but I would say stay tuned and be cognizant of the fact that we're going to have to come back and we have to have a quorum to start things.
Can you elaborate on what you mean by that?
We have to have 34 members here.
But why do you think there'll be so much absenteeism?
I think that there's certain individuals who don't want to vote on this issue. I think if it was clear that this issue was important enough, it would have gone through the regular process. If you look back on the last session, you saw this process in place before. It was on the permitless carry legislation, remember? You see, we went to committee and we voted out a bill, but it was not to the liking of the leadership of the supermajority. So they took that bill to what committee? Rules. And now they're bringing this bill to rules so that it can be controlled. We will be here to fight for women's rights.
The example you used with a person choosing between pregnancy and dialysis, couldn't you argue, though, that going off of dialysis could present significant permanent impairment of the life of the pregnant person, and therefore that an abortion could be allowed under that circumstance?
Yeah, you could. I could. Will the doctor do that? This is not a choice for a woman. This is a choice between life or death when it comes to the health of the woman and that child. You cannot do dialysis when a woman is pregnant. That child will be harmed. So what do you do in that scenario? And think about it. Viability? That doesn't even come up. That doesn't even come up in this legislation. That's an important issue when it comes to abortion rights. And now it's no longer in the legislation. So, stay tuned. We're going to have some interesting conversations.
Are you concerned at all that this legislation could have a chilling effect on Indiana's doctors, potentially driving good doctors out of state?
It's a good question. We've been through this before. And the executive who started that problem ended up being the Vice President of the United States when we went through RFRA. This is the start of RFRA. And if you don't believe me, just watch when people get a hold of this piece of legislation and find out that we have an outright ban on abortion in Indiana. It's going to get worse. And we are going to be the only legislature in session dealing with this issue, as far as I know, next week. So all eyes will be on us. We can no longer hide. And as Abdul so eloquently put, they caught the car. Now they don't know what to do with it.
Are there any concerns that this could have economic impacts that companies could not want to come here because of the pollution from?
Economic impacts, it's going to be an economic tsunami. Here's the problem. The package that they actually, in the finance packages that they've offered, are reopening the budget. If you remember, we asked that very question when we were here on the last special session. Senate Democrats said we need to open the budget so that we can give relief to taxpayers. Now, all of a sudden we're opening the budget, and notice the language specifically said allocated from the budget to women's health, postpartum treatment, economic, I don't know what this utility tax, gas tax is, but that is going to be reopening the budget. Where's teacher pay? Where's support for families in childcare? Where's support for families that need assistance just to get by? During this last special session, they took food stamps away from people during the last time. And now they want to talk about helping them pay for the utility bills? It's inconsistent, and it's actually taking us back. And like I said, we're supposed to be moving forward, and these pieces of legislation help us move back.
On the abortion bill, and I asked the same question to the Republican, but do you consider this a total ban?
Absolutely. And if you don't, just look at the language. Rape or incest. But you asked another very good question. Where's the criminal penalty? Where's the incentive for a doctor to report? Where's the incentive for someone who provides the abortion or gives it? Where is it at? Where's the disincentive, disincentive for that? There's no criminal penalties. They're having problems. They're having trouble because they didn't listen to Hoosiers. And Hoosiers have said over 75% stay away from women's health. We are okay in Indiana with where we're at. And that's what we want to do as Senate Democrats. We are okay. And we don't need an outright ban on abortion in Indiana.
Senator, on inflation relief, the bill doesn't include the governor's $225 checks. Do you like that, or would you like to see that put in?
$225, we always said that it's, listen, whatever economic package they have to give relief to Hoosiers, I'm supportive of. However, if you're going to do it the right way. And don't play games with the money. Remember, this is not our money. These are taxpayers' dollars that are being paid in. Listen, the top revenue source for this surplus is, guess what? Sales tax. So that means Hoosiers are spending money, right? So if they're spending money and you give them another check, they're going to spend what? More money. Thus, inflation goes. I agree with President Pro Tem Rob Ray. But here's what I don't like. They're using that money for credit. For credit. We have a AAA credit rating, and that's more important than feeding families. Child care tax credits. Why not give a tax credit to people who need child care? We have a child care problem in the state. We could do other things other than just saying, hey, we're going to suspend for a short period of time your tax on gas. Is that going to help you in January? Is that going to help you in February? Maybe. March, you're on your own. Thank you, guys. Unless anybody has any more questions. Oh, I do want to say this, too. Going back to my point about having problems with this piece of legislation. When we started down this path of considering, after the Dobbs decision, what we were going to do, I made the statement that we don't have to do this right now. We don't have to spend taxpayer dollars to come here and talk about abortion. We have a legislative session coming up in January, and we could take care of it then. We do. And if we do anything, we should provide relief to taxpayers because we have their money. But I believe that there's a small group of the supermajority in the Senate that don't want to be here either. So it's your job to find out who those people are. But in the next coming days, you might find out more and more information. So thank you for your time.